You are listening to a free version of the Majority Report with Sam Steeder. To support the show and get another 15 minutes of daily program, go to majority.fm, please.
The Majority Report with Sam Steeder.
It is Wednesday, November 1st, 2017. My name is Michael Brooks, and this is the five-time award-winning Majority Report. We are broadcasting live steps from the industrially ravaged Gowanus Canal in the heartland of America, downtown Brooklyn, USA. On today's program, Milton Allimadi, the publisher of Black Star News. We're talking about why are there over 5,000 U.S. troops in Africa? Our covert actions there, our core partner in Uganda, who has been involved in triggering everything from the Rwandan genocide to the growth of Al-Shabaab in Somalia, and why we still support him. All that and more with Milton Allimadi. Small terror attack yesterday in New York City. 8 dead, over 11 injured. That and one suspect arrested. We'll touch on that later. New polls indicate that Americans are open to a tax cut, but not a giveaway to corporations as Republicans delay unveiling their tax package yet again. Steve Bannon, he wants Trump to get tough on Mueller. And so far, Trump is only tantruming on Twitter. He's apparently not planning on firing Mueller just yet. That could, of course, change in literally a matter of seconds. Australia has a new strategy for dealing with refugees that I would imagine the Trump administration might be very interested in. Starving them. We'll get to that. And the open enrollment for the ACA begins today. All that and more on today's Majority Report. Matt, can you turn me up what I hear, please? Thank you. Let's start with a little bit of, well, I can't hear anything now, so it was just the music's off. I'll know in the, I'm quasi freshly shaven. I shaved about 2 days ago. My mom prefers a clean shave every time she sees a clip of me. First, she never watches the show when I'm not hosting, and then she sees it and she goes, "Why don't you shave?" She's like, "I don't get that whole Brooklyn nonsense thing. Shave." And I actually kind of agree with her. And when I do agree with her and I listen to my mama, I use my Harry's razor. Harry's are the best. And they are, I mean, I have very sensitive skin. So the fact that I shave with these things, and they last for a while too, shouldn't push it too long, in my opinion, with anything. But how long do you last with her? I think you go even longer than me, Matt.
Yeah, I go about maybe a week with a blade, so three or four shaves.
Which, no, that's about right.
Yeah, like, and
you couldn't do that with most other brands.
No, well, I would, but by the end of it, it'd be dull. The thing I like about Harry's is I can keep that pace, but also it's a nice shave each time.
Exactly. It's close, it's smooth, it gets the job done, it's a comfortable glide. And Harry's has a special offer for our listeners. They are so confident that you're going to love their blades just like we do, that they're going to give you their trial set for free. For free. When you sign up at harrys.com/majority report, just pay for shipping. Harry's is all about a great shave at a fair price, which is why over 3 million guys have switched to Harry's. Jeff and Andy, two ordinary guys who are fed up with paying overpriced razor, fed up with buying overpriced razors, started Harry's to fix shaving. I always think of Bernie when I read their spiel. Because it's true. They saw a monopoly. And they busted up. They bought their own German factory with over 100 years of blade-making experience to ensure the highest quality. All products are backed by a 100% quality guarantee. Harry's offers their blades at half the price of the leading five-blade razor, selling directly to you over the internet. Claim your free trial offer today from Harry's today at a $13 value for free when you sign up. Just cover shipping. Your free trial set includes five weighted ergonomic razor blade, five precision engineered blades with lubricating strip and a trimmer blade, rich lathering shave gel, and a travel blade cover. To get your free trial, go to harrys.com/majority report right now. It's harrys.com/majority report. Let's do a little bit of sound here. Let's start with this Don Jr. thing. So we're run by a cartel of disgusting people in this country, and part of what makes them disgusting is they have absolutely no self-awareness. Donald Trump is a trust fund baby who had everything handed to him, and his children are trust fund babies who've had everything handled to them, and they don't even have the sort of bizarre sociopath psycho charisma of their dad. And Donald Trump Jr., who just for this alone, I hope gets indicted for, like, you know, treason, okay? Or at the very least, he's going to have a very hard time at the re-education camps when we take over, tweeted this out yesterday for Halloween. It's a picture of his daughter, who's a cute little girl. I don't know what her... Was she dressed as a cop? I can't really tell. Of course.
I think she's dressed as a cop, yeah.
Great. Very, very non-cliche move there, Don. I'm going to take half... And he tweeted this over her picture. I'm going to take half of Chloe's candy tonight and give it to some kid who sat at home. It's never too early to teach her about socialism. Says a moron who has never worked for anything in his life. Except for maybe his father's affection, which he'll never get. Oh, the pathos. But I like this because this is the distilled essence of the lazy cliches that pass for policy in this country. Like, this combined with, like, a late night infomercial for real estate scams plus this tweet could give you the backbones of the entire Republican policy apparatus. This is Paul Ryan's budget in a tweet. And and maybe even slightly less disgusting because it's at least an attempt by a stupid person at humor.
Someone I know also made the point that he thinks it's work to walk around having people give you things.
Yeah, well, you're walking. Walking's hard.
Also, he spelled two wrong.
Oh, yeah, the T-O-T-O-O, you dumb, you idiot. Didn't I teach you better
idiot.
Than that?
I should have beaten you more at Penn. What did you say, Brendan?
Ratio is pretty good, too.
The ratio is pretty good. Yeah. She still has a lot of candy in her bucket. Anyways, sad, pathetic, and not good.
We're in your head, though.
We really are in their heads, aren't they? It's amazing.
I'm in your head, kid.
This is the moment. Our historical task right now is for all of these plutocrats and sociopaths and trust fund babies and grifters and all of these just horrible specimens that make up the American wealth elite and global wealth elite to look back on this time and think to themselves, if we didn't have to try to steal that last 2% that was up for grabs, we could have had 98% and continued living like that without any accountability. Why did we have to be so greedy? Because we pushed it and we pushed it and we pushed it. And then that little moron sent this tweet out. And then we ended up losing like more than half of our shit. That's our task right now. Away offers high-quality luggage that is designed to be resilient, resourceful, and essential to the way you travel. You know, folks, I love to travel. That's why I try to keep about a 40 to 60 work show-up ratio. And when I travel, I need a good bag. And I am excited about my Away experience. Available available in a variety of colors and four sizes, including carry-on sizes that are compliant with all major U.S. airlines. We know how insane the airlines are. The away suitcase is lightweight and made with premium German polycarbonate that's unrivaled in strength and impact resistance. Not to mention it features TSA-approved combination lock, four 360-degree wheel spinners, and a patent-pending compression system to help overpackers. I'm not an overpacker, but I certainly know some people that are, and that will help a lot. Better yet, both sizes of the carry-on are able to charge anything that's powered by a USB cord. That's awesome. A single charge will power your iPhone 5 times. I had an opportunity. I traveled with this once recently, and it didn't even occur to me how annoying it was to not have away luggage. Like, I didn't realize how much my experience sucked until I had this luggage. It was amazing. Try away for 100 days. Vibe with it. Travel with it. Instagram with it. And if at any point you decide it's not for you, return it all for a full refund. That's insane. Shipping is free within the lower 48 states. It's crazy. They give you 100 days. When you get this thing, you're definitely going to want to keep it. And thanks to Away's lifetime warranty, if anything breaks, they'll fix it, so you've got nothing to lose. For $20 off a suitcase, visit awaytravel.com/majority. Use promo code majority during the checkout. That's awaytravel.com/majority. Promo code majority for 20 off your Away suitcase. Last night, on the Michael Brooks Show, we interviewed, I talked with Anoa Changa about this new notion that's being pushed in the sort of dum-dum center that it's Russian bots that have created black activism in this country. In fact, if you go back historically, the czars lured the early American states into slavery just so that they could plan hundreds of years ahead for the Trump presidency, which I did not know about until reading some Daily Kos blogs. We talked about that. Nathaniel Friedman and I talked about how the NBA is transforming fandom and the arms race.
People might know him as Free Darko.
Jabari Brisport stopped by for a final Get Out to Vote push. He's doing great. I'm very proud of Jabari.
I'm canvassing for him this very evening.
That's awesome. If you're in this general vicinity, you should. And actually, even if you're not, there's a way you can get on. You can go and visit. What is his website again? It's Jabari. If you look up Jabari Brisport on Google,
he's at Jabari 2017 on Twitter.
And at Jabari 2017 on Twitter, you can. I think there's a way that anybody could phone bank for him from wherever you are.
I got called by some dude in Iowa, and I'm like, oh, yeah, actually, I've had him on the podcast a couple times.
Yeah, you're like, suck it, Iowa. And then we had a post game, and then we debuted a new show called A Hysterical Man Speaks Calmly with Sam Harris. And we had on, quote unquote, guest Jordan Peterson. So check out the Michael Brooks Show on iTunes or catch up on YouTube or join our 700 and something patrons as we sort of close in on that initial 1,000 patrons goal. Patreon.com/TMBS. We'll be right back with Milton Allimadi on the Majority Report. My theosis, then I'm bringing on hatred, Sicilian. Nobody shoot me. My body's made a hand grenade. Girl bled to death while she was tuckus in the razor blade. That sounds sick. Maybe one day I'll write the horror. Blackula comes to the ghetto. Jackson Acuba. Stevie Wonder sees crack babies. Be killing enemies in their own families. I'ma get them coming up when we soon done. Gun by my side just in case I got the rum. A boy on the side of Babylon trying to front like you're down with Mount Zion. Take the Welcome back to the Majority Report. I'm Michael Brooks. Joining us now is Milton Allimadi. He's the publisher of Black Star News, and he's an adjunct professor at John Jay College. Milton, my friend, how are you?
Hey. Thanks for having me on your show again, man.
It's a pleasure.
You're doing well.
Pleasure.
Yes.
So, Milton, we had this these deaths of these four U.S. Special Forces in Niger a couple weeks ago. I think from an American perspective, this is going to be the second time that Niger has appeared in the news, the last time being in the Bush administration with the uranium yellow cake lie, which helped set the stage for the invasion of Iraq. But this is a window into, in fact, a very aggressive space of U.S. kinetic activity on the continent. It also gives us a window into a lot of stories about regimes that we are supporting there, and various forms of politics that, unfortunately, there has been a bipartisan consensus on supporting in the United States. But can you just briefly explain the context for what happened in Niger, and specifically how many U.S. troops are operating on the continent right now?
Okay, to be honest, in terms of how many troops on the continent, it's even hard to know.
Right.
Because a lot of this, even some members of Congress were surprised to find out that there are U.S. troops in Niger in the first place, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I've seen accounts ranging from 800 to 1,000 in Niger alone. And on the continent, I've read anywhere from 6,000 to 10,000. And it could be a lot more. And specifically to that region, Niger, which, of course, neighbors borders Mali and also borders Libya and Chad and Algeria. And that's all a very volatile zone right now. So there are a number of stories in play, but let me try to hone in a few to try to make some sense out of all of this. First of all, we started hearing a lot more news from that region after the collapse of Gaddafi's regime in Libya.
Right.
And why is this key? Because both Niger and Mali, both French colonies, had a huge population of the Tuareg, who are known as nomadic people from the desert in Niger and Mali, who were in Libya. Many of them were working in Libya. Many also were serving in the armed forces in Gaddafi. But they're working in all sectors, because their zone is it's very hard to exist there in the Sahara, right? And they've been ignored since independence in the 60s in both Niger and Mali. And many of them left and were working in Libya, trying to make a living there. After the collapse of Gaddafi's regime, they were targeted. So they returned, hundreds of thousands returned to Mali and returned to Niger, where there's really no form of existence, except for what you can do if you're holding a gun. And you know what people do when they're holding a gun. So that is the broader context. In Mali, in 2012, there was a military coup which the French seemed to endorse. But then after the military got rid of the elected government there, the Tuareg saw that as an opportunity for them to fight for a separate state, something they've always wanted. So they started pushing from the north toward the south. And they had a good chance of like getting rid of the new military government in Mali. So that's when the French, remember that big French military operation with thousands of troops? I think there was about 4,000 French troops with fighter jets.
Yes.
And they pushed the insurgency back. But also, as a consequence, you know, sort of allowed the reintroduction of civilian government in Mali, the same military that they had supported. You know, now everybody was eyeing what's going on in the region, so it wasn't a good time to be supporting the military there. But during that time of the crises, other groups that come into Mali from Libya, and those are the ones that were affiliated with the Al-Qaeda in the Maghreb, they call themselves.
Right.
And they want to set like a more stricter a regime following the Sharia, or at least that's what they say in many of the videos that, you know, they put out. And those were fighting the government in Mali as well at the same time. So there were two separate agendas there, you see. Mm-hmm. The Tuareg just wanted their independence because they'd been marginalized and ignored. But the Al-Qaeda entities, and those are the ones that are pretty much still active up to now. And yeah. The French have been... Go ahead, sorry.
No, finish your thought.
Okay, so the French based in Mali have been targeting them, and the French also based in Niger have been targeting them. But at some stage, the European Union and the U.S. had also now become involved, ostensibly, purportedly, in support of the French mission against the Al-Qaeda elements. But all of this also, we can't ignore another umbrella above all this, which is the economic interest involved. Mm-hmm. Niger and Mali are major sources of uranium for France.
Mm-hmm.
I think France powers its electric energy, I think more than 70 mil, maybe even as high as 80% comes from nuclear energy. So that's why Niger and Mali are very important to France. And recently, the U.S., I think, have become more involved in sticking out economic interest in Niger as well, uranium as well as oil. And after that, China is now involved.
Right.
I think China won a major concession to bid to search for oil in Niger. So I think the U.S. has increasing presence in Niger to try to counter China's influence. So that's the broader context in which all these things are happening. It's not happening out of the vacuum.
Right, of course not. And then just to kind of underline a couple of other themes here that are related to what you're saying, and I would like you to sort of accentuate. So Okay. Number one, and I really like that you sort of positioned those different uprisings and their distinct claims, because this is another thing that's happening right now. Especially when we talk about areas of the world that people have, I mean, you know, that are undercovered and people have very little understanding of, and then to be just more on the less critical ends, that just more objectively, there's just less resources and access points to, you know, people having a solid grounding in what's happening in Mali as an example. But that Al-Qaeda and now ISIL, maybe in some respects as well, to the extent that they're sort of franchising and globalizing.
Right.
There's two different...
Since 2015, right. Go ahead.
Right, and there's these different versions of colonialism happening. There's a neo-colonial move and competition, which is essentially another sort of West versus China conflict. And that's who's going to partner with emerging African economies, who is going to get access to this new wave of natural resources that people are quite keen on exploiting in Africa. We could also add some of the bioprospecting that, as an example, Saudi Arabia is doing in Africa as it thinks about, and all of the issues that anyone would expect, whether you're talking about the United States or China or France or Saudi Arabia, anybody that you would expect. There, people's land is getting appropriated. There's policies being written that favor corporations and foreign direct investors over local people. That's one dynamic. And then the other dynamic that is that, you know, groups like Al-Qaeda and ISIS are actually running their own parallel miniaturized terrorist version of that same dynamic. They're going in and they're exploiting longstanding historical and contextual, and in many cases, like the Tuareg, legitimate grievances.
Yeah.
And then they are ascribing their own just religious, fanatic, terrorist-oriented version of another outsider colonial narrative. And then the whole terrain becomes a battleground between imperialisms and colonialisms from the United States, China, the EU. Then a colonialist terrorism from groups like Al-Qaeda or ISIS, or their spinoffs like Boko Haram. Boko Haram is a good example, because Boko Haram actually fuses some of those really legitimate concerns and claims, and then have adopted the methodology and ideology of these global terror networks. So maybe you could just jump more into these multiple colonialisms and how they're clashing right now and how that leads all players to support some of the types of regimes that we're going to get into, including, of course, Uganda.
To be honest with you, the way you just broke it down, I don't see anything you can add to that.
Okay.
Honestly.
Okay.
You broke it down really precisely. The only thing that is quite glaringly obvious, even to me listening to you lay it out and to the listeners out there, is that really governments in many African countries really don't control the countries they claim they rule.
Right.
That's a summary.
Right.
Who controls Niger, really? It's not certainly the government there. It's not.
Right.
It's right now the people that are actually in charge are the French, the U.S., and to a great extent now, China. You laid it out perfectly. There's nothing to add here. It just shows that we are at a space that is comparable to 1884-1885, the Berlin Conference, when the European countries, they wanted to avoid multiple conflicts like this, right?
Mm-hmm.
So what did they do? They met in Berlin under Otto von Bismarck, and they partitioned the continent. They said, France, this is your area. Britain, this is you. Portugal, this is you. In order to avoid what we are seeing going on today. But, you know, I was thinking about this as I'm listening to you. You know, so we're seeing now the opposite of the Berlin Conference when the partition was done in an orderly manner. Then today, it's not being done in an orderly, in a formal way. Right now, that's why we have these multiple struggles to stake out areas, and that's what we're witnessing on the African continent today.
And I want to be clear: the reason I break it down so well is because I read you. So, that's
no,
why.
But you laid the summary is perfect,
yeah.
Man.
Okay,
you know, it's actually quite scary,
right?
To put it bluntly, you know.
Yeah,
it shows like a disempowerment. People in the elite that were once in charge are much more beholden now to their puppet masters in the West, and now, of course, China is a new player on the block as well. It's this neocolonialism on steroids.
Yeah, that's and also in parallel to the time when, you know, Africa gets the Economist cover and there's this changing brand representation of Africa, which I guess on a certain, you know, on a marketing level is positive, right? It's like, oh, well. You know, I mean, though it just belies how one-dimensional and frankly condescending and racist the narrative was before. But now it's like, hey, Africa's not just this poverty case anymore. Now Africa's this incredible, exciting realm of opportunities for growth and investment. But what does that actually mean is exactly what we're just outlining.
And how does that translate to the ordinary folks on the ground, right?
Right.
All these mineral resources, and the folks that are really going to benefit out of all this are the outsiders. Imagine Niger has been producing uranium for France since before independence and much more so since 1960s. And Niger, if you look at its ranking on the United Nations Human Development Index, it ranks absolutely last in the world.
Right. Right.
I think the literacy rate is it's about 20-something%.
And so some of the only, and this is the other kind of very important thing to note, that even like going back to Libya, I mean, you know, people talked about these as an example on the side of people fighting for the Gaddafi's regime. One of the reasons Gaddafi was able to last as he was collapsing was, you know, he brought in basically freelance fighters from Chad.
Yes.
And, you know, this is another thing that like, and of course, I'm not justifying any groups or excusing war crimes, obviously, that anybody
right.
committed in Libya. But the, you know, the way it was presented here was like, oh, these crazed, you know, rapists and killers from Chad. The reality is that Chad has an astronomical unemployment rate. There's no resources
right.
or context for anything. And right. you know, Gaddafi was literally sitting in front, and there's amazing accounts of him sitting in front of a PayPal account with a satellite phone,
right.
just
right.
directing money that translates to like nothing to essentially get the equivalent of day laborers to come in and create a private army, because that's how bleak the economics are.
Right. And in fact, even up today, with its collapsed country, there's still some people from other African parts of Africa that are working in Libya, even with in the state that it is today. But the other thing, as you know, of course, that also escalated the influx of people that are using Libya as a transit zone to try to get across the Mediterranean,
right,
and to go to Europe. And that in itself has created another dimension as well in human trafficking. People from as far as Nigeria that are going through Niger in order to try to make it through Libya and to go to Europe. And then let me just back up a little for a second about the crimes that were committed in Libya.
Yeah.
Let's not forget that some of the biggest criminals actually were the so-called, I remember at one time, the New York Times used to refer to them as revolutionaries. But then at some point when it became obvious that these guys might actually be worse, and in fact have proven to be worse than the government they were fighting to topple, they stopped calling them as revolutionary. I never referred to them as revolutionary because to me, people that were cutting off people's head and posting it on YouTube, that's not my kind of revolution, you know, my image of revolution. I could not bring myself to believe that the same people that are cutting off people's head, posting it on YouTube, are going to be able to run a responsible government after they got rid of Gaddafi. And now, behold, no surprise.
Right. And the other kind of dynamic too, and I think that it is important, at least for me, to not, you know, we have to hold all these things simultaneously. And obviously, Gaddafi committed many atrocities. But the other dynamic,
yes,
is that, you know, I think there's always a fusion of genuine uprisings. Then there are these terrorist group influences, and then there's,
yes,
also like the other part of people opposing Gaddafi are, you know, some of the most,
yes,
egregious members of his regime who picked the right,
yes,
moment to defect. So how are,
yes,
they going to, you know, a guy like Musa Kusa is not,
yes,
going to,
exactly,
represent different politics. I mean, that's insane.
Right. Right. Or forget Musa Kusa. Also, what's his name? The one who's leading the Eastern government now,
yes,
that does not recognize Tripoli.
I forget
General
his
Shifter.
Name, but oh, I,
yeah,
can't
Shifter,
believe.
I think. Is,
yeah,
his,
yeah,
name.
Yeah, right, right.
He used to be, he was a CIA agent, in fact.
Right.
Yeah, he lived very close to CIA headquarters before he went back after the collapse of, when Gaddafi was about to collapse. And now he's supported by Egypt, and there's a good possibility that he may end up being the guy on top.
Right.
And then the other dynamic, of course, are all the weapons that were let loose after the Gaddafi regime collapsed. I remember seeing a documentary showing caravans of, you know, vans of Tuareg coming back to Niger and Mali, and all they had were weapons. They didn't have much belongings, but they had vans and vans and vans and convoys of weapons.
Right.
And that's why also the entire region became very volatile.
It's a currency of conflict. Yeah.
To Chad, to all the way to Nigeria. And that's how Boko Haram became resupplied as well, in terms of having access to better weapons.
Right. All of the light weapons that we let loose in that region. Now, let's
Absolutely.
Talk about an individual. And we should say, you know, you are, you know, you cover and teach many things and have, you know, many expertise areas, but you do have, you are of Ugandan descent. You,
yeah,
work on these issues, and obviously,
right,
the situation there is of, you know, very specific concern to you. The president of Uganda, the dictator,
right,
Yoweri,
right,
Museveni, who you, I'm sure, will correct me because I'm confident I mispronounced at least part of that, and I apologize. Or maybe in his case,
no,
I don't.
You had it right.
Oh, I did? Okay, great. All right. Wow. You know what? I'm improving my pronunciations, man. So he has been in power since, I believe, 1986. And he has managed to basically have a parasitic and mutually dysfunctional client state with the United States through all of these iterations that we've been talking about, from fighting communism, quote unquote, to fighting terror, to being a poster boy for neoliberal economics on the continent. He is a case study of all of the policy dysfunction of the United States in the region, as well as popping up in all of these decontextualized points of crisis that get mentioned in the West. Al-Shabaab, civil war in the Congo, even Joseph, the infamous Joseph Kony from that video.
Right.
Who is Museveni and how do we support him?
We support him because he functions just as Mobutu used to function meeting U.S. interests and U.S. agenda on the African continent. Just as folks like Marcos used to be very useful for U.S. interests, Mubarak used to be useful for U.S. interests. Museveni he's very adept. So when Ronald Reagan was president, he was a big champion of the free market, World Bank, IMF structural adjustment, right?
That was the brutal austerity that hit developing world from the West before it came home to roost, as it has in our capitalist crisis in the last couple of years.
There you go. Absolutely. Right. You know, no subsidies for healthcare, no subsidies for fuel, no subsidies for anything, you know, that so-called invisible hand. Right.
Right.
Yeah. So he embraced that. So they loved him. Reagan had him at the White House. So today, he markets himself as the champion, the bulwark against, you know, Islamic quote-unquote terrorism, right?
Mm-hmm.
And he stationed about 8,000 Ugandan soldiers in Somalia. Somalia's been volatile for like almost 20-plus years now. So long as he's willing to base Ugandan soldiers there, we don't have to send U.S. Troops on the ground. He can get away with anything in Uganda and anything in the region. Let me give you the latest example of what he's doing and how hypocritical he is and how cynical he is, right?
Mm-hmm.
He invaded South Sudan in December 2013 because there was a falling out. There was a dispute, political dispute between Salva Kiir, the vice president, and Riek Machar. No, I'm sorry. Salva Kiir, the president, and Riek Machar, the vice president.
Of South Sudan.
Unity government. South Sudan, right.
Yes.
And some of the regional presidents were trying to mediate. But Museveni, who was supposed to be one of the chairmen to mediate, sent his soldiers to take sides. And it was very brutal. And since then, South Sudan has been in this conflict for very horrendous, you know, massacres, killing of children, of women. So as a result, millions have fled South Sudan, and Uganda alone hosts about 1 million refugees from South Sudan. So what did Museveni do in June? He hosted an international solidarity with refugees a week in Uganda and invited the UN Secretary General and other world leaders to attend.
Right.
And they went, and they were all calling out for the world to mobilize resources to help South Sudanese refugees in Uganda, and they were thanking Museveni for being this great host. What's wrong with this picture? There's a million refugees in Uganda because he's the one that actually ignited the inferno in South Sudan. But who's going to be talking about this? He knows you won't see editorials about this in the Wall Street Journal or the New York Times or the Washington Post or on CNN or the BBC. You know, the story he knows that is going to be adopted by corporate media is, here's this, you know, African leader who's unusual, opening his country to 1 million refugees. Who ever heard of that? We must support that. Let's send the funds needed. And when the money gets there, I don't even have to tell you where it's going to end up, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know where it's going to end up.
Yeah.
That's just one outrageous example. But he's very adept. He knows how to, how to market himself to the West and what to say and to whom to say. That's where he's far ahead of people like Mobutu, far ahead of people like Mubarak, and that's why he's lasted for such a long time.
Yeah, I mean, another great example of this from earlier, you know, back in the early part of like around 2002, 2001, 2003, there was, a, and I've mentioned this at other times on the show, when we focused on South Africa, we've talked about the controversy around the former president Thabo Mbeki's AIDS policies, one that certainly warrants criticism, but it's its own topic. The point being that this is at a time when Thabo Mbeki, who of course for all of his many, many flaws is a, you know, you can't even compare him and Museveni as leaders in terms of things like human rights. Museveni right. swooped in and implemented by what many accounts was a socially conservative, but still the bottom line was he distributed condoms in Uganda.
Yes.
And this got him, I mean, that was how I first heard of this guy. It was like,
Absolutely.
This is the guy in Uganda who gives condoms out. And exactly. this was how he was rid, and this was how he was in the West at that time. That was the right move.
And talks about it publicly right. and have billboard and has commercial right. all over the place, and nobody else is doing this. While cynically, at the same time, he had deployed soldiers who were known to be HIV positive right. in areas that the insurgency were going on, particularly in the eastern and northern part of the country. And those soldiers were specifically targeting civilians.
Right.
And raping both males and females.
Yep.
And spreading AIDS.
Right.
That's how cynical he is.
And he was still praised by the Bush administration and hung out with Bill Clinton during this time.
Absolutely.
Right.
Because he knows there's some things they will never write about. They'll write about the things I want them to write, at least when it comes to the so-called major corporate media.
Right.
Who, by the way, the more we talk about it, the more dangerous that we realize that they are actually... for African interests, but not only African interests, even domestically.
Definitely. Of course. That's where it all sort of links together. So, I mean, the kind of main themes here are there's a neo-colonial moment in Africa that implicates everybody yeah. from the United States to China to ISIL. There yeah. is a, there's this period where, you know, there was this, and then there's this kind of very ossified and dysfunctional leadership on a fair yes. amount of the continent, which is exemplified in our relationship with Museveni. Maybe yes. if we could give some people some, but at the same time, even though there is this neoliberal economist cover version of isn't Africa exciting? It's this growth continent now, which we want to critique and undermine because that narrative and those policy goals are not going to help any type of normal African. But at the same time, there is, and I hope that maybe we can leave on somewhat of a positive note, there is this thing, there is these African awakening movements, which, you know, didn't get as much attention as the uprisings in the Middle East, but were connected.
Right.
And there was
yeah.
a friend of mine actually who runs a group called The Rules. He worked several years ago in Kenya on a campaign
yeah.
that defeated the proposal to put a value-added tax on corn, which is an incredibly
yeah.
serious issue there. It was a World Bank-backed
right.
plan. There
right.
is a new generation of African activists who are just as opposed to Western capital, Chinese imperialism,
yeah.
and African oligarchies, and they want a new continent,
they
and they're connected, and they're smart, and they're powerful, and they're doing new things.
Right, they are, and they know how to use social media. They want the Africa that Kwame Nkrumah envisioned, a united Pan-Africa that uses Africa's resources for Africans, Africans that can work together regionally and integrate economically and take advantage of the resources that they have. We saw an example in Burkina Faso when the youth threw out Compaoré, finally, after he had been there for 27 years, after he killed Thomas Sankara. And for anybody listening, please go to YouTube, watch Thomas Sankara, The Upright Man. It's a phenomenal documentary. It's very short, only 50 minutes. But Sankara was basically saying, we have to take control of our destiny. We can't be dependent on the West for everything. In my own country, which was called Upper Guelph, he changed it to Burkina Faso. Why do we import food from France when we can grow our own food?
Right.
Right? Why do we have to depend on foreign resources to build everything? We know how to build buildings. Why do we have to import our clothes from the West?
Right.
We grow the cotton. We have tailors here. We can create our own factories and make our own clothes. He started wearing Burkina-produced clothes. He said, why do we need all these Mercedes-Benz when our people are walking bare feet? That can't be tolerated. You know, we should, in fact, share cars. So he made his ministers get rid of all those Mercedes. Africans, the younger generation, are reawakening to that, because when they drove out Compaoré and reintroduced democratic governance in Burkina Faso, many of those young folks were not even born when Sankara was killed, were sporting Sankara T-shirts when they took to the streets and got rid of the dictatorship in that country. I think that's going to reverberate in other African countries, and the younger generation, who are very adept in using social media and communicating and know how it's being used in other parts of the world as well, I think they'll lead to the next wave of independence in Africa.
Milton Allimadi, it's always a pleasure and an honor to talk with you. I admire your work immensely. I hope that we got to start doing
likewise,
it more again.
Likewise, I admire your work as well. And we wish you had more people doing this kind of journalism, because then it would be very hard for the so-called mainstream corporate media to get away with covering up some of these things that never get written about.
Well, let's Burkina Faso the mainstream corporate media.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you. Milton Allimadi, publisher of Black Star News, adjunct professor at John Jay College, and just indispensable journalist on all things African. Okay, everybody, we are going to go to the... Okay. We are going to go to the fun half. Become a member of the Majority Report today, majority.fm/member. Become a member. Fill out our survey. The survey's still up, right? Yep. The survey's still happening. Let us know whether you are a freebie or a member, you know, how you discovered the show. All those questions in there, they're really simple. They're not very long at all. If you're interested in the sponsors today, check out the homepage for Away and Harry's. If Matt had it, I forgot that. I think it was An Upright Man. Maybe we could find the link to the documentary that Milton recommended. I'll try to find it and hopefully tweet it out later. You can also obviously find my show on the majority.fm homepage. We are going to go to the fun half, 646-257-3920, 646-257-3920. The IMs are open. See you in the fun half, everybody.